Good evening and welcome to our first final of the IFSC Lead World Cup season 2016. I'm Charlie Bosco with Delaney Miller alongside me this evening, and we are coming to you live from Chamonix. Sitting at the foot of Mont Blanc, Chamonix has always been a climber's paradise. The town itself is a bustling hub of activity and is home to 10,000 people who enjoy incredible access to some of the best climbing, skiing and mountaineering on the planet. What would be considered extreme elsewhere is nothing unusual in Chamonix, and the whole town has an energy and enthusiasm for climbing that is hard to find anywhere on the planet. It's no surprise, therefore, that we get a warm welcome. And the venue isn't too bad either. The Place Mont Blanc in the heart of Chamonix town centre. The bad news, unfortunately, from Chamonix is that the rain has just recommenced. We've just had 3 or 4 hours of beautiful weather. You could see the summit of Mont Blanc, but unfortunately the clouds have come back in. We hope they were clear. In the meantime, Delaney Miller, you climbed in today's semi-finals when the weather was pretty terrible.
Yeah.
Tell us how you find the climbing and the nature of the routes.
I found the routes quite confusing, to be totally honest, but I think a lot of girls did. It was very difficult to read. Our route essentially looked like volumes with jibs and then terrible pockets.
If you didn't see our semi-final earlier, there were quite a few girls who slipped off. Unfortunately for her, Delaney, you slipped off lower down on the route. But the benefit of that is that we get your insight. And what were the conditions like? How did it feel to climb in that rain?
It was definitely very humid.
Obviously, I should point out the wall itself is dry because it's so overhanging, but the rain was falling hard at the time.
Yeah, the wall was dry. The humidity was high. And nothing on the ground was dry whatsoever. Before I pulled on, I had to chalk up my shoes and get them as dry as possible.
And you can just see, hopefully, in the background there, as the MC warms up the crowd. Yeah, the clouds have clagged back in. The umbrellas give away the fact it's raining. But on the whole, you think conditions are still better than they were earlier?
Yes, I do. At least it feels drier to me. It hasn't been raining for a couple of hours, so things have definitely gotten a chance to dry out a little bit.
And we'll just quickly run you down the order of who we have competing in the two finals today. First up, Romain Desgranges will be followed out by Francesco Vettorata, Gutia Zupper, Sean McColl, Sebastian Hellenka, Jakob Schubert, Domen Skufic and Stefano Gisolfi will make up the rest of the final. Bear in mind the climbers come in reverse order, so Stefano Gisolfi qualified first out of the semi-finals. Mina Markovic will climb first. We originally thought she'd been excluded. She was ninth provisionally after the semi-finals, but after an appeal, she was moved up to eighth, so she makes the final after all. She will be joined by Charlotte Juriff, Anne-Sophie Koller, Yuka Kobayashi, Anak Verhoeven, Magdalena Rock, Jane Kim, and Yanya Gambre. As we see the crowd getting warmed up here, we were talking about it in the semi-finals, and last night, this crowd in Chamonix turns up, rain or shine. It was raining extremely hard in the semi-finals. By Chamonix standards, we didn't have our normal crowd, but they've turned up tonight, and spirits are high. Speaking of last night, Delaney was alongside me. We had an aborted attempt at the Speed World Cup final. That was rearranged. Delaney and I had a good chat for half an hour, but unfortunately we didn't have any climbing to talk about. That was rearranged and it went ahead at about 3:30 p.m. today. If you haven't watched it yet, I won't give the results away. So as we look out across the Place Mont Blanc, it's a legendary venue for World Cups. Delaney, how have you found the Chamonix experience? I know it's not your first time here, but how do you find it as a place to visit?
I love Chamonix. Honestly, if I could live here, I totally would. But I found out today that property here is very expensive.
Property is very expensive. I lived here for a long time and could never afford much more than the shoebox, unfortunately.
Yeah.
Well worth the price, though, to live in this valley. And speaking of living in this valley, there's a man who does just that, Romain de Grange. He snuck into today's semi-final. Looked very strong in the qualifiers. In the semis, he did just enough. Francesco Vetturata out. He was a provisional leader for a while during the semi-finals. Spot somebody knows in the crowd. There we see Romain de Grange with his Chamonix jacket on. Here's Gauthier Zuppe. He's fired up. He's trying to get the crowd to be the same.
And he won this comp last year.
He did. He was second overall last year to Adam Ondra, who isn't taking part in this year's World Cup. So Gauthier will be feeling confident. Strode out onto the stage. Big smile on his face. Got him pumped up. Here's a man that always gets the crowd going. Sean McColl. I've lost track of how many World Cups Sean's already done this year, let alone the career. He thinks it's, I believe, 110, perhaps? Certainly plenty of experience.
He's so humble, too. Honestly, he came off the wall today and he was like, oh, I got lucky that I squeaked in.
We should point out, actually, if you watched our semi-final, Sean, I believe, was provisional sixth or perhaps seventh. He's moved up two places either way. He had an appeal, and his score went from 40 to 40-plus in the semi-finals. So he's moved up two places. He was in the final anyway, but he's in a different starting place. There's Sebastian Hellenka, unmistakable figure. Here's Jakob Schubert. He can win anywhere on any day. Qualified third out of the semi-final. Here's Domen Skofic. You can check out our chat with him on the IFSC Facebook page. Spoke to him yesterday. He's in very good spirits.
Seems like he's looking really good this year.
Climbed very well in both the qualifiers and the semis. Stefano Gisolfi, though, the man they couldn't catch. He didn't quite top the route in the semi-finals, but he wasn't far off. He got closer than anyone else, so he will start last in today's final. There's the eight men competing tonight. So the men will have their inspection period. Now, during the inspection period, do you tend to keep your beater to yourself? Are you a secret beater finder, or do you just say exactly what you're thinking?
I say exactly what I'm thinking. Personally, I like to use the time mostly for myself to do what I can to memorize the route, and then maybe like last minute start discussing it with others or discuss it in ISO. And I think that's what most girls actually do.
Now, when you're inspecting a route like this, you see Jakob Schubert there, and all the climbers are going to move further down onto the Place Monc itself to have a look at the upper moves. Do you try to remember individual moves, or do you just try to memorize a crux section, or is it just the style of the route and psychologically you're trying to prepare?
I try to memorize like where the holds are and like specific sequences that I think are going to be tricky, because those are the sequences I want to discuss with others back in ISO.
And you do discuss them with others?
Yes.
Are there many climbers who sit there just with their iPod on, keeping themselves themselves?
Most girls discuss the route.
Yeah. It's been interesting in the Boulder World Cup so far this season, because obviously we have the group inspection before the finals of the Boulder, and some of the people we've had commentating say, I don't actually say what I'm thinking.
And
really? Other people are just light yourself completely open. So you try to remember as many moves as you can and particular sequences.
Yeah. remembering routes is actually one of my bigger weaknesses as an athlete, though. I personally have a hard time with it.
Is there something you can do to combat that? Are the memory techniques, do coaches discuss route inspection when you're training?
I think maybe just practice.
It's interesting. We see in sports like Tour de France cycling, which is passing through Chamonix next week, people talk about marginal gains, areas where you can improve by 1%. Maybe there's something there.
Yeah.
Memory coaching for lead climbers. Who knows?
Yeah, I think that has potential.
If anyone makes some money out of it, feel free to send a check my way. You heard it here first.
I'll be the first customer.
Sebastian Helenka. Checking out some of the higher sections. The climbers are allowed binoculars, it should be said. Sean McColl leading discussions here with Jakub Schubert on his left and Domen Skofic on the right. So if you are new to lead climbing, the holes are numbered. You can't see them on the wall, but the judges have a full page photo of the route, which they've very kindly given us a copy of. Has a photo of the route and the holes are numbered. Your score depends on the hold you reach. Delaney, instead of me explaining it, talk us through, from an athlete's point of view, the scoring system. You get a number, but then there's also the option to get a plus on that number.
Correct. And usually the plus is just forward movement. Sometimes it can mean bumping up to a previous hold.
Okay. So if you get to hold number 30 and you're controlled on hold number 30, you're totally solid. Let's say you don't make the hold number 31. To people watching, try and talk us through what you need to do to get that plus, even if you don't quite latch the next hold, hold 31.
From my understanding, there just has to be upward body movements.
And the hand as well?
I think in the hand as well. Maybe I should.
Well, no, it's interesting.
No.
I'm not putting you on the spot. I was chatting to a judge, and there is some ambiguity. Theoretically, it's a movement of the hand towards the hold and the shift of the center of gravity.
Yeah.
But there are occasions where it can be just one. So there is some ambiguity, so I didn't mean to put you on the spot there.
I suppose as long as the judge is consistent, it doesn't really matter.
That's absolutely right, yeah. And as you can see from the fact that we had two appeals in a World Cup semi-final in a well-established sport like lead climbing, Sean McColl, who was already in the final, changed places, and Mina Markovic, who wasn't even in the final, after an appeal, ended up in the final. It is not an exact science, scoring in lead competitions. It's always worth remembering when we flash up a score up on screen and when you give it the score, these are just provisional scores for that reason.
It's difficult because sometimes the setters disagree on the numbering, so there's not always a perfect method.
That's one of the beauties of climbing, but it can also be a frustration. It's not an exact science. Every time we do a competition, the boulders, the lead climbs, the routes, they're all different. And so the rules can't be as fixed as in some sports. But as you say, as long as the judges are consistent,
yep,
and as long as the competitors feel they've been treated fairly, we will have a result everyone's happy with. So yes, the climbers are scored on the last hold that they get to before falling off. Or they get to the top, which they're all aiming for. I should point out, we didn't have any tops in either the women's or men's semi-final today here in Chamonix. So we see the climbers here, they've got their observation period. When you're observing, I've just said there were no tops in the semi-final today. Do you sometimes think to yourself, you know what, I'm just going to really learn the bottom two-thirds of the route because that might be enough? Or do you just always think about that the route as a whole?
I always make sure I look at the entire route. But like I said earlier, I just focus on the crux sections that I really need to know. So if they're in the bottom two-thirds, then that's what I focus on.
So it's more you focus more on what you think will be the crux rather than where it is?
Yep.
It'll be interesting as this lead season goes on and we get different people in the commentary box. Is that the standard approach? Are there different ways? It'd be fascinating to find out.
But I do also have to say that I really make sure I know the first 10 moves, because that helps me set a good pace for the rest of the route.
So you really try and get the first 10 moves dialed, and then in your head you might have a crux sequence, but other than that, there's an element that you're on-sighting the route.
I mean,
obviously in strict climbing terms you are on-sighting it, but you know what I mean?
Yeah.
You don't feel you have much prior knowledge other than the first maybe 10 holds and then the few crux sections.
Yeah.
It's a complicated business, route inspection, and the climbers should be out very shortly. They've gone back into observation, myself and Delaney Miller alongside me, are ready for the action. Just to run you down who will be competing in tonight's men's final, if you're just tuning in, Romain Desgranges, Chamonix local, will be out first. He'll be followed by Francesco Vettorata, Gutier Zuppa, Sean McColl, Sebastian Halenka, Jakob Schubert, Domen Skoffic, and Stefano Gisolfi, having come first in the semi-finals, will climb last in tonight's final. We can see, unfortunately, the rain coming down in Chamonix, but as ever, the crowd filling up nicely, and the way the weather's been the last couple of days could well change in 5 minutes. We could have a perfect view of Mont Blanc with the sun setting. Venue MC, you might be able to hear him in the background just warming up the Chamonix crowd. This is the Place Mont Blanc in the town centre. People sitting down. Oh, gives me a cold backside thinking about it. So I believe our first climber is about to emerge. Will be Romain Desgranges. He's lived in Chamonix for a long time. And he does it all, Romain. Indoor, outdoor, boulder, lead, you name it. Coached by Fabrice Juden.
He's one of the older competitors to make finals, yeah?
He is, yeah, he's 34 years old, which doesn't sound very old, but it's quite an amusing moment. Probably wasn't very amusing for Romain Desgranges when he was climbing, and Yanya Garnbret was next to him, and she was exactly half his age. So as well as their observation period, the climbers also get 40 seconds at the foot of the route to go through final rehearsals. And that's what Romain is doing here. See Home Servos in the bottom left of your screen. It's a little village, 20 minutes drive down the valley from Chamonix. But he does train in Chamonix in a gym 100 meters or so from where we are right now.
What do they do with the wall here? Does it stay up?
No, it comes down. It goes up every July, goes up and it comes down again. The Place Mont Blanc normally has some sign that the wall is being put up about 2 weeks in advance. See there on the top righty screen? 8 minutes per competitor. That is the maximum time allowed. Delaine, you've had a quick look at these routes. What do you think the style of them will be?
If I were to guess, mostly power endurance, which is to be expected. That move right there looks quite powerful. So I expect no good rests on this route, just mostly like keep up a good pace and yeah.
Power endurance. So as I say, Romain climbed superbly well in the qualifiers. So far he's making fairly light work of this route. Looks like we're entering the beginnings of the crux section.
Yep. He's moving very confidently, so that's good. I think that'll be necessary to get to the top on this wall.
You can see the experience of Romain there. Manages to get a bit sneaky foot jamming.
Yeah, smart.
To give you some idea, this section of the wall that Romain is on is about 45 degrees overhanging. Doesn't quite look it from this angle, it's just an unusual angle. It's a good view of the climbing, but you can't quite see the overhang. There you get a sense of it. You can see the angle his chalk bag's hanging at. We're off the triangular volumes and into a series of very rounded blue holes, heading up for another three triangular volumes. You can see them up there. Raman making very light work of this so far. He's up in the middle of the huge volume in the center of this Chamonix lead wall.
He's actually already over halfway through point-wise for the route.
He is, yes. And he's not too far. I'd say maybe 3 more meters away from getting off the steepest part of the wall. Not showing any sign of fatigue just yet. Romain de Grange firing out of the blocks. As I say, looked really strong in qualifiers. Not quite himself in the semis, but enough to make it through to tonight's final. Now, these blue volumes, if you've been watching the IFSC Boulder World Cups this year, these will look very familiar, these half moon volumes. Raman just beginning to struggle here, uses his toe effectively there. Just an awkward clip, the rope's just running behind his leg. Needs to get that sorted.
He's got it.
Chamonix crowd getting right behind Raman de Grange. Again, clever climber for Roman. He seems to be finding rests all the way up this route.
Wow.
Just see on his face, fatigue beginning to show.
Yeah, he's fighting.
Four minutes 20 to go. You'd imagine time not an issue for Roman de Grange. He is nearing the top panel on this wall.
Those holds look so bad.
Terrible sloping holds. Yeah. The last thing you want when you've just pulled off in a 45 degree overhang.
Wow, he's almost there though.
Raman de Grange, first World Cup was in 2003, 13 years ago.
Oh. That was a good run.
He also won his first World Cup in Imps, that was last year. He's won here in Chamonix in the past at the European Championships. Looks slightly disappointed.
I don't think I've ever seen him finish happily. But I wouldn't be surprised if that was podium.
It's very hard to tell, obviously he's the first climber out.
Yeah.
Not over the moon. But he can now go in, his work is done. He's fifth overall last year, he still doesn't look happy. Very difficult to go first, because you just don't know what you need to do. You don't know, you could be first, you could be last. Roman, from his body language, certainly seems to think he could perhaps have done a bit better.
Certainly seems like he went very efficiently and fought really hard.
It certainly seemed a very good effort from us into the last 10 or so holds on the scoring system. We'll get his score confirmed shortly. Oh, and he goes straight out to sign an autograph. Remember, if you've been watching the Boulder World Cups where the climbers disappear back into isolation, we don't have that in lead climbing. Roman is now done for the evening. So out now we have Francesco Vetterati, who's a provisional leader earlier in the semi-finals. Pulled straight onto the wall. Don't think he had his full allowance there for pre-inspection. Just wanted to get on with it in front of this ever-growing crowd. 24-year-old from Sedico in Italy. So Roman de Grange climbed this lower section very quickly. Francesco, I think, is already slightly slower. Nails that first dyno. I think we might see one or two climbers slip off that. Very low down on the route. So Francesco finished sixth in Stavanger last year. Maybe looking to beat that. He's also ninth in Purs last year, just missing the finals.
Not moving as quickly, but he is looking strong.
He is looking very strong. So there's the foot jam that Roman had. How much role do you think nerves play in this? We saw Francesco come out. It looked like he got straight on the wall, possibly slightly nervous. Do you climb better when you're nervous?
I think nerves help to an extent. But I don't know. It's definitely, it is a mental game. It's like more of a mental game than anything else almost. But as long as you can stay calm even with those nerves, then you're fine.
Great aerial shot there provided by our DJI drone. And Francesco looked like that shoulder move with the right hand took a bit out of him. He's now on the very steepest part of the wall.
What's going on? Oh, it looked like she was saying something.
Sorry?
It looked like they were calling him to do something.
False alarm. We thought we had the judges calling him down. No, we don't. Phew. Had some career highlights. Francesco second, Arco Rockmaster 2014. His home country. We'll be back in Arco in August, but in the meantime, we have the legendary Chamonix World Cup to enjoy. And Romain de Grange came out, a Chamonix local, with a real statement of intent. He's being followed now by Francesco Vettorata. So he's moving now onto those half moon volumes.
Smooth looks big.
Got the heel hook sorted. Go with the right hand, just about holding that.
That looks like such a scummy heel hook.
And we make some moves over the left. So above that black line cutting across the wall, the angle of the wall changes, it eases off, but unfortunately the quality of the holds deteriorates. You can see those two blue volumes and the third one just appearing top left, there it is. They are not great holds. Above them two orange volumes, Romain de Grange not quite make it that far. Francesco just set himself, getting his hips into the wall. Francesco Vettorata, round hold 44-45 there. I say, sixth last year. This is best finish of the year. It certainly stands a chance with that performance of improving on sixth. He's down with 3 minutes 15 to spare. Looked slightly happier about it than Romain de Grange did. You can see what it's taking out of him. Panting away. For those of you just tuning in this Tuesday evening, we're live in the legendary climbing town of Chamonix. In the Place Mont Blanc. And he also goes, Francesco also goes to sign some autographs.
That's the fun part.
Absolutely. Yep, we're in the Place Mont Blanc, centre of Chamonix. Delaney Millet, Team USA, alongside me. And I should actually rectify a mistake I made earlier. You are from Frisco.
Yes.
As I said in the semifinals, but I thought it was Frisco, Colorado. It's actually Frisco, Texas. Don't mess with Texas. I'm sorry.
Sorry. I love confusing people because I've been living in Colorado for the last couple of years. So now when they say, where are you from, I don't know what to say.
Is Frisco a climber's town?
Frisco, Texas?
Yes.
Absolutely not. Not even close. There's no rock climbing there.
Really? How did you discover climbing? Just while we wait for our next competitor who will be Gutierrez Zupper. How did you find climbing?
I went to my friend's birthday party.
Was it, was it love at first sight?
Yeah, it was.
Here's Gutierrez Zupper. We mentioned it earlier. Very interesting. Second overall last year. Second to Adam Ondra, who this year is not competing. So Gutierrez is a, logically you would imagine, one of the favourites this year's overall title. He pulls on for the first move of the first final of 2016. Almost jogged up the first couple of moves. Yeah, he was second overall last year, eighth the year before that. 25 years old. From Chamonix, that's not too far from here.
Looks like he's struggling a little bit.
Now there's a bit of a jump move here.
There we go.
It would have been a surprise if he'd come off there. All the climbers have made it relative ease, but a dyno that low down, certainly the potential to catch someone out, especially if it starts to rain again. Seems the rain has either eased off or stopped altogether, but if it starts to rain again, humidity increases. Could cause some problems. Gutierrez Zupper had a fantastic year last year in the World Cup. So just run you through his results. Starting out in Chamonix, 2015, he was fifth. He then won in Brianson. He was fifth again in Imst. Won again in Stavanger. So he went fifth, first, fifth, first. And then broke the trend slightly. Fourth in Perz. Seventh in Wujiang. And finished the season with eighth in Kranje. Made every final and won two. If it wasn't for a certain Adam Ondra, he would likely have been lead World Cup champion.
Did Adam compete here last year?
He won the overall event, so I'd imagine so. Let me just check that. Well, with perfect timing, our internet connection has gone down in the commentary booth. Ah, here we go. So I can't confirm that. I'm certain Adam did, but I will just double check it for you. As Gutierrez Zupper makes his way up into the three triangular volumes in the steepest part of this wall here in Chamonix. Gets a big cheer from the French crowd.
He's looking good.
He's looking strong. I wonder if it's nerves. Looks super relaxed the first couple of moves, but he's found his composure now. Yes, there we have it, confirmation. Adam Ondra did compete here in Chamonix last year. He was second. Gutierrez gets a big cheer, as I say, apart from Romain de Grange. He's by far the most local climber in tonight's men's final. one notable absentee from tonight's final, Ramon Julien Ramonet. He won here last year. But he didn't go well in the semi-finals. He didn't go well in the qualifiers, to be honest. He didn't manage to find his form overnight, and he was knocked out this morning. Looks like some fatigue going in, almost slapped that left hand. And we saw a drop knee here from Francesco. Gauthier just opts to take an extra rest. If you can call it that on a 45 degree overhang.
Wow.
So once he pulls over that lip, he'll be on lower angle terrain. See the fatigue kicking in.
He just needs three more holds to be in the lead.
Looks, they are pretty terrible holds he's resting on. As you say, not too far off. Take your provisional lead here. As you'll see, he's getting much more of a rest at this lip than anyone else did. Time, you would thought, not an issue. 2 minutes 30 and he's off the steepest section of the wall. Amazing to see how much rest he can actually get on these terrible sloping holds. That's one last shaker. No, he comes back down for more rest. And he's latched it. Gauthier's up, but he's on, almost onto this lower angle section. Gets the orange volume. No, you just saw his leg kick in frustration. That'll be enough to give him the provisional lead, though. Gauthier's up. He's down on the concrete of the Place Mont Blanc. Fantastic effort, therefore, from Gauthier's up. Next climber out will be Sean McColl. After an appeal, he was given a plus to his original score, and as such, he's moved up the order. So we haven't had the scores updated just yet. Gauthier Zupper, I'm fairly sure, is in a provisional lead. We should check in just a second. We'll just wait for a score to update on the computer system before we confirm Gauthier's score. Romain Legrange did hold a provisional lead with 47. Francesco Vettorata was on 43 plus. And here's Sean McColl. Veteran World Cup climber in all three climbing disciplines. One of the few climbers that participates in all three. Delaney, you're a bit of an all-rounder. Do you think that by doing all three you compromise each individual one, or for an exceptional athlete like Sean, do you think you can actually be at your best in all three?
I don't know about at your best at all three, but I think Sean is definitely exceptional for being so successful at, like he is at all of them.
Yeah, he was provisionally seventh, Sean. He moved up to fifth after his appeal. Last time he was here in Chamonix, he was 11th, didn't quite make the final. He made the final the next week in Briançon. We will be down in Briançon as we get a fantastic aerial view thanks to our DJI drone up in the sky. It's the Place Mont Blanc as we pan across Chamonix Town. And back to Sean McColl. Just about to say we will be in Briançon in a couple of weeks. In the meantime, we had Villar. A very busy schedule for the start of the IFSC League World Cup season. Sean doing that move quite differently to the other climbers.
I actually really think this route suits him.
What makes you say that?
Just because it seems very dynamic and it's very much a you can't stop and Sean never stops.
We were chatting off air earlier and you're saying that these routes could reward a slow climber. Not a slow climber, but a slow and steady. I don't mean slow as a negative. I mean someone controlled and steady. Just talk us through what you meant by that.
I think more than anything with these routes, you have to be very committed to what you're doing. And there are no mistakes. There's no room for an error. So, and Sean is always 100% committed to his movements. So
far, looking exceptionally controlled, Sean. That shoulder move out right that Francesco Vettorato looked as if it took a lot of energy out of him. Sean cruises through, bit of a messy clip there, slightly awkward one. The quick draw just sitting on his stomach. I don't think he's used up too much energy and he's into the volumes. One of the few climbers, Sean, to have won World Cups in both lead and bouldering. Can he repeat a lead World Cup win tonight? Last lead win was Xining in China 2012. He's always there or thereabouts in lead and bouldering.
He made that heel hook look really good. He's looking good on this section.
Had some time back home in Canada since the Vail Boulder World Cup. They're getting some much needed repair work done apparently. Plenty of visits to the physio. It certainly seems to be paying off because he looks in great climbing form now. Doesn't seem to have been overly troubled by any of the moves so far. And we saw Gutierrez up and move up here. Take a lot of rest. Sean resting slightly lower down. And he's up here very quickly. Over 4 minutes still left on the clock. Slaps with his left hand. Needs to get his feet sorted. Has done now. Moves out to those orange square volumes and just pops off.
He looks psyched.
As ever, Sean's first thought, wave to the crowd, give them something to cheer. Yeah. Always very popular at the World Cup, Sean, and rightly so. And there he is. Gives a wave of the hands as if to say, oh well, not much more I could have done there. Still smiling. So just to confirm, we haven't had Sean McColl's result just yet, but Gutierrez is up. Did get one hold further, further than Romain Legrange and Francesco Vettorato. We shall wait to get Sean McColl's confirmed score. The next climber out will be Sebastian Hellenka. There you go, it's not hard to miss. Comes out, ball of energy. Well, Delaney, you should be getting some memory tips off him. It looks like he knows the route like the back of his hand.
Yeah, maybe I should. He's actually one of my favorite climbers because he's always so positive in ISO. It's really nice listening to someone who has such a good outlook on everything.
Just expand that a bit. How do you mean he's positive? Is he just chatty or he doesn't just sit there with his headphones on?
I mean, he does have headphones occasionally, but like whenever you talk to him, it's just always good things that come out of his mouth.
Always
he's always smiling.
Always good vibes. We like that.
Yeah, and even whenever he does get angry or frustrated, he tends to let it go pretty quickly.
Still just waiting for Sean McColl's score to hit our computer system. In the meantime, Gutierrez Zuppa has a provisional lead and Sebastian Halenka is on the wall. Sebastian, last time he was here in Chamonix, third in the IFSC World Cup 2015. That was his best result of 2015, so he started strongly. It'd be somewhat harsh to say he dropped off, still appeared in three more finals. And then we see Sean McColl, now 46 plus. Puts him in provisional third. Sebastian, seemingly not using the foot jam that we've seen climbers using in between those two volumes, those orange volumes that he has his left hand on. He was 7th overall in 2015, Sebastian. And I think most people feel he has it in him to go better than that. Still only 21, remember. The MC getting the Chamonix crowd behind him. That right shoulder move. Again, didn't seem to have too much trouble with it, just gets himself set, having a few problems getting his feet organised. There we go. Again, not a comfortable clip this one. Quick draw sits in the climber's lap. For those of you just tuning in, we're live in Chamonix Mont Blanc, the heart of the French Alps. Team USA elite climber Delaney Miller's alongside me. Thus far, we've had a pretty close men's final. Things very tight. You suspect that if a climber can top this route, it could be enough to win here. I don't know if we'll see more than one top. Sebastian taking quite a long rest here. Probably half a dozen or so moves behind where Sean McColl was after this amount of time, but he won't be too worried about that. He'd be more worried about conserving his energy for higher up. Delaney, what's your personal tactic? Do you try to rest, or is rest slightly negligible on this sort of terrain?
There's usually not a really great hold where you can just sit and camp out. So I'm notoriously known for being very slow. I like to just like rest as I go.
Okay. The reason I ask is we've seen climbers resting in different places, which would back up what you say, that there isn't an obvious huge hold to rest on.
Yeah, I suspect that those holds are not very good, but they're good enough.
I had a look from the ground, and a bit lower down we were on the cherry picker, the machine that they use to bolt to get the holds onto the wall, and we use it to mount our camera. We had a quick look at the holds. It's certainly not great, but it's been very interesting how the climbers have rested in slightly different places. Sebastian, you can see just beginning to shake a bit, fatigue certainly beginning to kick in. Trying to fight the pump in the forearms, but he is heading for lower angle ground. Sebastian, the fifth climber on the wall. The four ahead of him have been Gutierrez-Zupper, who takes a provisional lead. I will resume in a second. So Gutierrez-Zupper have a long series of shakeouts here. Sebastian doesn't want any. Gets straight on, slips off again. That seems to be the move that's stopping quite a few of the climbers. Looks slightly frustrated with himself. She'll await his score. In the meantime, Gutierrez-Zupper followed by Romain Legrand, Chaumacol and Francesco Vettorata is the order of the four climbers who've been ahead of Sebastian and whose scores we already have. See there, unfortunately the rain does seem to have resumed here in Chamonix.
The good thing is it's getting cooler out, so maybe the friction will be better.
The temperature is beginning to drop actually. There's our speed wall. We had our Speed World Cup final early this morning. What a shot that is. Drone, our DJI drone up behind the wall. That's the back side of the wall looking onto the Place Mont Blanc. If a few people could just get their lighters out, like at a Bon Jovi concert, we'd have a pretty good view from up there.
How many people do you think are in the crowd?
That's a very good question. We have had 12,000 in the past. I suspect we're slightly below that due to the weather. Certainly several thousand. Then we have confirmation. Sebastian Halenka does enough to push Chaumacol down into provisional fourth. Remember though, the climbers climb in reverse order. So if you qualify first out of the semi-finals, you climb last. So very, very theoretically, the best climbers should be last. Obviously, it doesn't work like that. In reality, but theoretically, we should have the strongest climbers out last. But when you have people like Romain Legrand, Gutierrez-Zupper and Chaumacol in the so-called bottom half of the final, you know it's just a theory. Here's Jakob Schubert, 26-year-old from Innsbruck. Said he's been enjoying the good weather that Innsbruck's had over the past couple of weeks. Been getting out climbing quite a bit. On sighted 9A earlier this year, outdoors, puts him in a very elite category. Always a threat.
Where did he on sight the 9A? Do you know?
That's a very good question. I did know and I can't remember now off the top of my head. Let me see if I can find out. I'm frustrated, it's on the tip of my tongue. Certainly in the on-site 9A club. Jakob make his way fairly confidently up this lower section. No trouble so far. We'll concentrate on the action. If you can remember off the top of your head, or even if you have a sneaky Google and don't admit it, other search engines are available. Then let us know which was the 9A on-sighted by Jakob Schubert. Don't forget you can interact with us by the IFSC Twitter by hashtagging IFSCWC. Let us know, do you know which 9A Jakob Schubert on-sighted? It's actually driving me mad, so if someone could let us know. Because I did know, because I asked them about it, and now I've forgotten it. It's driving me insane, so someone, please let us know.
No, I'm sorry for asking.
No, it's fine, it's fine. Yeah, Twitter, hashtag IFSCWC if you want to interact with us, and if you could put me out of my misery and remind me which 9A Jakob Schubert unsighted. So Jakob, climbing relatively slowly here.
that sequence is a little awkward.
So, foot just slipped off. I was about to say it'd be a big surprise if Jakob Schubert wasn't right up there tonight. Veteran climber. Make his way towards the orange volumes.
You said that that section that he's on was about 45. I have to say that whenever I was on it, I swore it was like 60. It
well,
felt so steep.
I'm actually going off the information from our chief route setter, Adam Pustelnik, who joined me for the semi-finals. He said 45. I have to say, from being on the inside of the wall, so the reverse side from where the climbers are, when I was climbing up there to mount a camera the other day, it seemed as if it was steeper than 45. I can imagine when you're on it, it certainly feels steeper. Adam reckoned 45. I think it might be a bit harsher.
He's sandbagging all of us.
I think he is, yeah. Jakob, really struggling. You see his foot there with this clip. Do you have a tactic for clipping? Do you just try to get it done as early as possible? I know there's a slightly different scoring system in the States that involves clipping, is that right?
Yeah.
But when you're in a lead World Cup, do you try and clip as early as possible?
It really depends on my energy. Honestly, I just want to clip from the best position possible. But what's difficult about these routes is it's really hard to tell how the next hold is. So if I'm on a good hold, then I'll clip.
That sounds a logical approach.
Yep.
Here's Jakob. This is one of the positions we've seen climbers resting in so far tonight. I have to say, time in danger of becoming an issue here. Only 3 minutes 20 left. Worth remembering, Sean McCall, with 4.5 minutes still on the clock, had already pulled over the lip that is now at the very top of your screen, at the top of the spotlight. So, climbing slightly slowly, Jakob.
He's taking a lot more rest.
He is taking a lot more rest. He's going to have to fire through this upper section. So Jakob, he has used up a lot of time. Never ever bet against him in a league competition though. I mean, another shakeout. Nearing lower angle ground, Jakob, but he's got to negotiate these blue volumes first. There's the change in angle, that blue volume at the top of your screen, just to the left of the clock. It's the second time his feet have swung off almost involuntarily. Got them back on now. We've seen a few techniques here. We've seen a drop knee. What will we see from Jakob? Yes, another drop knee. Jakob.
He's struggling there.
He really is struggling, but he's does have time. 1 minute 40. It looked for a while as if he might be really pushed. I don't think time's going to be the issue here. It's whether he can actually hang on. He's fatigue really kicking in. You can see the way his shoulders are beginning to arch.
Fighting.
Well, Jakob Schubert, having looked in,
wow,
I was about to say,
there he is in the lead,
having looked in trouble, takes the lead. He looks relatively in control, albeit not as smooth as some of the climbs we've seen already, particularly Sean McCall, who climbed incredibly smoothly. But the end result is, I'm pretty sure that's Jakob in the lead. Somewhere around hole 48.
Should be a 48 plus.
Imagine so. We shall wait to hear from the judges. Jakob, big wave to the crowd. Cool shot that, with the chalk in the spotlights. In the foreground is Eddie Falk. He's the IFSC photographer. If you sometimes see him in the shot. That's why he's getting shots of the climbers. Whoa, Seem Jakob not in the provisional lead. 47 plus coming through. It'd be interesting to compare at some stage Gutier and Jakob's attempt. I have to say, I was with you. It looked as if Jakob got higher initially.
Yeah.
But these things happen so fast. Unless you see an instant replay, it can actually be quite hard to tell. So, Jakob Schubert, provisional second. Very popular climber out next, Slovenia's Domen Skofic. As I mentioned earlier, we had a chat with him yesterday, so check out the IFSC Facebook page to see that.
So I have here from Kai Leitner a text that says Jakob onsighting 9A was an April Fool's joke from his Instagram.
No!
Have I been had?
I don't know. It's on Kai Leitner.
Somebody clear this up for us. Have I been absolutely had and then strung along? 9A has been onsighted. It's certainly in the realms of possibility. Oh, if I've been had. And Jakob strung me along. I'm going to feel a fool. It wouldn't be the first time I could take it. As we watch Domen Skofic pull onto the wall. And I desperately try and deny the possibility that I've been absolutely fooled by by Jakob Schubert. I have to say, did used to make a climbing news show, and we did do an April Fool's where we claimed that one of our members of staff had on-sighted 9C. So I suppose nobody fell for that one, but I suppose if I've been had, I probably deserve it. So Domen looking very controlled so far. Made a breakthrough last year. By winning his first World Cup.
Domen looks like he's cruising along nicely. Not going quite as fast as the other competitors. He's taking a rest here, like Jakob did.
He's Domen headed towards that right shoulder move. Nice, makes a good landmark. Or the left undercling if you're Domen Skofic.
Yeah.
It's good to have these, although it's not an especially difficult move, it's good to have these landmarks on the route, but Domen, not very helpfully for us, chooses to do it differently. And again, struggling with this clip, this quick draw has caused all sorts of problems.
Yeah. Ooh, still struggling.
Domen, the confidence of this young man takes a look at the crowd. He's obviously enjoying it. Chamonix is a legendary climbing town, barely does it justice. It's a climbing mecca. I should say more for alpinism than sport climbing, but very much a climbing mecca, very much a climber's town, a knowledgeable bunch, this crowd. And Dom and really enjoying climbing in front of them.
He's got about the same amount of time left as Jakob at this point.
He does, yeah. Jakob, it seemed, was using up a lot of time lower down. Domen slightly faster through that series of orange volumes. Looking controlled up to now, you can just see a hint of fatigue in his movements, understandably, but one thing's for sure with Domen Skofic, he's not going to come off this wall until he's got nothing left. That doesn't look a great position to find yourself in.
I don't think any of the other competitors have done that.
No, this
very
is
nice.
I'd actually be quite interested to see, to re-watch how the other climbers did it, because it looks Domen Skofic trying all sorts of new moves. He's got himself in a bit of an awkward position with the rope around his leg there, but I'm sure he'll soon rectify that. Imagine he'll do the next move before freeing his leg. Yeah, using it, it would seem quite different beater to what we've seen. Much more compressed in these moves, and that right shoulder move that I mentioned that he did with the left hand, again, quite compressed the way he did it.
Seems like if you can climb with heel hooks up by your head, then you can be quite successful on these routes.
It's certainly working for Domen. I think we could be about to see another. No, he keeps that right foot down. Now we saw Gutierrez Supper having a long rest here. And given that not many of the climbers have got a huge amount further than those in holds 47, 48, which are just above Domen Skofic, he can spare a bit of time. Very controlled. Could be enough to put him in provisional lead.
There we go.
That will be enough to put him in the provisional lead. Domen Skofic, second to last climber out. And he is in the lead as things stand. No climbers got their hands higher than the bolt-ons on those two orange volumes.
He's got about five more holds.
You can see the top. He's clipped the last quick draw. The next thing he has available to clip is the top of the route. Oh, Domen Skofic.
Such a good effort.
Fantastic effort from Domen Skofic. You could see the fatigue kicking in, but he just would not give up. It just goes to show, for all of us climbers, just go for one more move. If you get that, you might get the one after. You don't know. Just keep going, keep going. Domen Skofic, a good example of it there. Once he got himself stabilised on those two orange volumes at the top of the route, it seemed like he recovered. And I'm actually surprised he couldn't go any further. It looked like he recovered quite a lot of energy. The route obviously doesn't let up. I say obviously because we haven't seen any climber get any further than that just yet. So just to confirm, Domen Skofic straight into the lead, 51 ahead of Gutierrez Zupper in 48 in second. Jakob Schubert, 47 plus, who we originally thought might be in provisional second. He's in provisional third ahead of Romain de Grange, Sebastian Halenka, Sean McColl, Francesco Vettorato, currently in seventh place. Stefano Gisolfi, who won the semi-final this morning, is up next. Chamonix crowd, and there is Stefano Gisolfi. Lives a couple of hours south of here in Torino, Turin, if you are English speaking. In the heart of the Alps, beautiful Italian city. Not a bad place to live as they go. So, as I say, Stefano Gisolfi was top in the semi-final.
The gym there is really pretty too. I trained there last year and it was so nice.
And the gym in Turin, Torino.
Yeah.
What type of gym is it? A boulder wall, a lead wall?
Primarily lead wall. They do have a small bouldering area though.
And what's so nice about it? I might pay a visit on the way down to Brianson.
The routes were really good and it was just nice because it had a nice big window. So lots of natural lighting. But I really liked the routes.
So for those of you just tuning in, we are on our final climber in this men's final. Domen Skofic currently leads the way. Stefano Gisolfi, the last climber out, is the only man that could do anything about that. Best result last year was seventh. He was fifth in Pers and Savanger. He was seventh here in Chamonix. So no podiums for him last year. He is a lead World Cup winner, though, Stefano Gisolfi. Wujiang 2014. We're back there later this year for a speed climbing World Cup, Wujiang, China. Stefano looking very controlled up to here. Again, finding a slightly different spot for a rest.
Just like a really good hold too.
Just to give you some orientation of where he is on the wall. He's slightly past a third of the way up and he's about to enter the steepest panel. That panel above him is where the really steep terrain is. I was told earlier by our chief route setter, Adam Pustelnik, that he said it's 45 degrees overhanging, but Delaney Miller sat next to me, has been on it. She said it's steeper and I've been up to it on a cherry picker and it looks steeper to me as well. But we'll go with 45. Let's be tough on the climbers.
So he's about halfway through, point-wise.
Yes. He's making his way onto these series of blue blobs, blue volumes. Cheetah Holds, our sponsor this week in Chamonix, providing the holds. They have provided some really interesting holds for the competitors. Stefano not matching the pace of Sean McColl up the route so far, but nobody yet has been timed out. Nobody's really come close to it, so certainly from what we've seen, time shouldn't be an issue. Jakob Schubert seemed to be burning up a lot of time, but in the end, still wasn't timed out. And Stefano, a bit like Domen, doesn't do that shoulder move quite the same way. With the right hand and then just immediately after followed it with the left.
Seems like both methods are equally challenging.
Now this section seemed to slow Jakob Schubert down. Stefano take his time as well. Looks very in control though. One of the multi-discipline athletes we have at the IFSC, Stefano, does speed climbing as well. Made his lead climbing debut here in Chamonix in 2009, in the same year made his speed climbing World Cup debut. Take part in our final today though, earlier on, because he is in this so far superb men's lead final. Can he displace Domen Skofic at the top of the leaderboard? See the effort just beginning to show on his face there.
His body still looks pretty good, though.
It's the first sign of fatigue we've really seen from him. And it was only a brief grit of the teeth.
Yeah.
Very composed so far. Taking every opportunity to rest. Rested very low down on the route. Took another one in the steepest part, and now he's getting a third good shake out. I wondered if we were missing something there. The Chamonix MC suddenly just exploded into life. I think he was getting the crowd revved up for this, because this is Stefano Gisolfi looking to take the win. Okay, so to give you some orientation, there's these two orange volumes, that one and the one to the right of it. Just one more hole beyond that, and that is where Domen Skoferic's attempt ended. And Stefano so far... Oh! I think that will be enough for second. Yep. Pretty sure. Stefano Gisolfi lowers off. Superb effort. Looked in complete control. Very composed. Quick wave to this Chamonix crowd. And we will wait for his score to come through. And 99%, that was enough to get him second, which would push Jakob Schubert off the podium. And there we have it, yes. Domen Skoferic, first place provisionally here in Chamonix. Remember, we do have an appeal system. We did have the occasional change of result, but as things stand, Domen Skoferic, you'd have thought, pretty safe with that win. Stefano Gisolfi, 48 plus. Gutti is up at 48. Jakob Schubert, 47 plus. Romain de Grange, 47, both on 46 plus. Sebastian Hellenka and Sean McColl, and Francesco Vettorata is 43 plus, and he will come in eighth. So we now await the women. Well, that was a superb men's final. Domen Skoferic absolutely powering his way to the win. Nobody else got close to him. So, in the women's competition, just to run you through the starting order, we're going to have Mina Markovic out first. We originally thought Mina Markovic wouldn't make the final, but after an appeal following the semi-final, she is back in. She's reinstated in eighth place. She'll be followed out by Charlotte Jurif and Sophie Collet. Yuka Kobayashi, Annette Verhoeven, Magdalena Rock, Jane Kim, and Yanya Garnbrey. Remember, that order that you're seeing the climbers in, that was the order they finished in the semi-final. They were come out in the reverse of what you've just seen on your screen. So Mina Markovic will climb first. First, though, they will be introduced to the Chamonix crowd. And there's the MC, who's done a great job. Barely stopped shouting at the crowd for 2 days now. Done a wonderful job. And his next task is to invite out the female climbers. And here they come. Mina Markovic out first. So close to missing this final. When we left you at the end of the semi-final, she wasn't expecting to make it, but after appeal, she does. That was actually one of the big stories in the semi-final. She's just about made it in. Didn't look herself in the semis. She didn't climb especially efficiently. Lots of going with the wrong hand and then having to correct, but still did enough. And when she's in the final, you can never, ever bet against her. Charlotte Jurif the only French lady in tonight's final. Then we see the Chamonix crowd really filling out, almost back towards the Hotel Alpina in the background there. You can see, I believe that's a Slovenian flag being waved right in the middle. And Sophie Coller comes out, Swiss climber from Biel. She even got gloves on. That tells you what the temperature's like here in Chamonix right now. Really dropping. Yuka Kobayashi makes her way out onto the mat. There's Anna Verhoeven out onto the mats. She'll be joined shortly by Magdalena Rock. Here she is, part of Team Austria from Landeck in the Vorarlberg region. All the climbers, you can see Anna and Magdalena there squinting into the powerful spotlights. There's a big crowd out there. Might be easier if you don't see them. Keep the nerves under control. Here's Jane Kim. Qualified second out of the semi-finals. Next out onto the mat, we'll have 17-year-old Slovenian sensation Janja Garnbret. First in the qualifiers, first in the semis. Can she make it first in the finals? Not long to find out now. Here she comes. 17 years old, climbs like a veteran.
She did quite well here last year as well.
Yeah, she only entered three lead World Cups in 2015, second, second and third, not a bad return. In the meantime, she won last Sportiva Legends only bouldering competition in Stockholm back in November. She's also entered some Boulder World Cups this year. Second in Innsbruck back in May. Extraordinary climber. What have the female competitors made of her emergence? Are people still waiting to see if she can back it up long term, or do people think this is a really long term threat, Janja Garnbret?
I'm sure it is.
I'm pretty sure it is too. So the women just have this observation period now. Six minutes just to have a look at the route, try and memorize as much as they can.
The wind's picking up.
The wind is picking up, yeah, just noticed that. Do you think that will improve the conditions, or is it already cold enough?
I personally think it's cold enough. But it'll probably improve the conditions.
It's easy for us to say it's cold because we're sitting still in the commentary box, but if you're actually out climbing these routes under the spotlights, probably feels a bit warmer. They might well be glad of the breeze. It's So just to remind you, our eight climbers this evening will have Mina Markovic out first with Slovenia, Charlotte Jurif of France, and Sophie Koller of Switzerland will be out third. She'll be followed by Yuka Kobayashi, Anna Verhoeven, Magdalena Rock, Jane Kim, and Janja Garnbret will climb last, having come first in the semi-finals. Delaney, we've got a look at the route on our screen, and we've also got a topo of it in front of us. Unfortunately, we can't show you the topo, but it's just to give us an idea of the numbers of the holes, so we can tell roughly what position the climber's in. But what are your first impressions of the route?
I think it's easier than the semi-final route.
Really?
And easier to read as well, because it's a little bit more straightforward.
So remember, we had no tops in the women's semi-final, or the men's semi-final, I should add. So what is it about it, while we watch the climbers, but what is it about it that makes you think it's easier to read? Is it just the pattern of it looks more obvious?
Yeah. And I think the girls would be excited because it's a lot crimpier versus the slopey looking pockets that we had earlier this morning.
Do you think there's an element of fatigue kicking in for the climbers after the route this morning?
I'm sure.
You think the shift in style will help that?
Yeah, absolutely.
I'm not sure if you overheard that. We just had a technical delegate pop over and tell me that Jakob Schubert had his grade moved up from 47 plus to 48. Well, I don't want to big us up too much, Delaney, but we called that at the time.
We did.
So Jakob Schubert upgraded from 47 plus to 48.
To be fair, it was hard to tell if he had actually gotten the 48 hold.
It was hard to tell, yes. But apparently he has been given it. The Chamonix crowd, we're now fully in darkness here in Chamonix. 20 past 10 local time. This crowd will be here for the duration. And Anouk Verhoeven leading discussions there.
I actually usually go to her for beta. She's quite good at it.
She looks very confident in her movements, very sure of what she's going to do.
Yeah.
As I mentioned in the semi-finals earlier on, I was chatting to her dad earlier. He was coaching me in pronunciation of her surname. I'm sure I'll still won't quite be perfect, but apparently I'm getting better.
And what did he tell you?
He said it is Verhoeven. People say Verhoeven.
Yeah.
Apparently it's Verhoeven. Flemish pronunciation. I'll be testing you. We'll be testing you throughout this round. So we just mentioned briefly on the route, the nature of the route. Are there any climbers you think this could suit in particular?
It's hard to say, but I think in accordance with the other routes here in Chamonix, the climbers that are a little bit more decisive with their movements are going to be the ones that are favored.
So decisive with movement. Do you think it will favor slower climbers or slightly faster?
It'll favor the climbers that are more precise.
Okay.
And so the slower ones, if they're that type of athlete, but they can maintain the endurance, then they'll be fine.
I see Jane Kim there being chaperoned off the stage. She was getting every second of looking at the route that she could. And if you can hear some noise in the background, we are right next to one of the cherry picker machines that the route setters use to lift the holes into place, and they also use it to lift photographers into the air so they can get better shots. And the seam, just putting someone up there now. A very pleased Jakob Schubert just walked past our commentary booth. He's been upgraded from 47 plus to 48 in the scores. There's that Chamonix crowd, as I say, Place Mont Blanc pretty full now. Be interesting to get an official attendance, but the venue spills into Chamonix town centre and the road, not to mention the road. So, certainly a few thousand here. Always get a good turnout, and we're getting fired up by the local MC. And this women's final is about to get underway. Some people having a great time down the front here in Chamonix. Have you had a chance to sample any of the local climbing since you've been here?
No, I haven't.
Some excellent sport climbing, particularly down the Arve Valley on the way to Geneva. Of course, we are moving on to Villars pretty sharpish after this World Cup.
Yep, two rest days.
Two rest days. Do you tend to take those as rest days, or do you try and do some gentle climbing or a short bouldering session or in between World Cups? What do you tend to do in between the events?
I don't really have a habit of anything, because it very much depends on traveling and where I'm going, what I've been doing. A lot of the times there isn't an option to climb.
It's Mina Markovic, as we've mentioned. Made it into the final on an appeal. Pleased to be here. But I don't think she was pleased with how she climbed earlier on. In fact, I know she was. But she has the opportunity to make amends here. It's our first look at this women's route. So you can see the men's route over to the left. So the panel's obviously the same. So they get gradually more overhanging for the first three panels, and then that final fourth panel kicks back ever so slightly. So Mina, make your way up the second panel. And this is what we saw a bit of earlier for her, just not quite sure which hand to lead with, not reading the route quite as well as she'd like to.
Yeah, a bit of hesitation.
29-year-old Slovenian. She is, of course, the reigning World Cup champion, which is why nobody here is betting against her. She hasn't quite looked herself so far, and again, either taking a rest or wants to change hands. Looks like she's going to change hands.
Yeah, I think she will need to, based on the scoring.
She has it, just to give you some idea. That's hole number 13 on the provisional route map. As I say, it is open to judges' interpretation. But the route setters believe that hold that she has her left hand on is hold number 13, excuse me. Through that section, got her hand sorted in the end. Now heading for the steepest panel. She doesn't hang about. Straight onto it. She wasn't planning on doing the World Cups this year, Mina Markovic. A I've chatted to her at the ISPO show in Munich back in January. She said she wasn't going to do them, but she's gradually come round, and here she is. She couldn't miss it. To be honest, when you can climb in a legendary venue like this in front of such an enthusiastic crowd, why not do it?
How long has she been competing?
Mina Markovic. She made her debut in 2004 in Imst.
Wow.
And as I say, she is the reigning World Cup champion. From the evidence of last year, she's the woman to beat. She won four World Cups and the European Championships last year. Made every final. Worst finish was 8th. Not a bad year. Now either Mina is back on the sort of form we expect from her, or the ruse is slightly easier to read than the semis. I suspect a bit of both.
Seems like a lot of the holds are a little bit better, which makes me wonder if some girls will have issues with the time, because they'll be tempted to stop and shake out.
It's an interesting point. We didn't see any of the men timed out. It is an interesting point. If the holds are better, they might be tempted to use up slightly more time, take more rests. Mina, you can see him. Yep. Tiredness just starting to kick in. Just a slightly jerkier movement as she went for that clip. But she'll still have a bit in the tank. She's still got plenty of time. 3:40. You can see there. That part of the huge red volume in the middle of this wall is pretty much close to horizontal. Not far off horizontal. Look at the angle her chalk bag's hanging at to get some idea.
She's halfway through the route now.
Mina, she will be about to pull off the steepest bit of the route, but it doesn't let up much. She's still got a long section of this 45 degree panel to go. It's time to fight now, Mina. Setting herself, no. Shakes out. Knee just beginning to twitch a bit, just a bit of fatigue. Here she goes. No. Not from Mina Markovic, around the whole 33 mark, maybe 34, we shall see.
Such a good fight though.
Fantastic fight from Mina. You can see the last minute or so of that attempt. Just beginning to get tired. She doesn't look too disappointed. I think she's delighted just to make the final. She's steered this way by one of the young helpers here at the Chamonix event. And I think she's saying, Mina, can you sign a few autographs? Some sort of discussion going on. For now, Mina just takes a seat. She'll sign the autographs when she's ready. Thank you very much.
She probably wants to get her shoes off.
I'd imagine so.
But I think she just sat down on the wet ground. Next out will be Charlotte 3.
If you're wondering why we're seeing someone with a huge chalk bag full of tools and a top rope being allowed to pull on the quick draws, it's because Mina Markovic is told our judges that there's a loose volume on the route. So one of our superb route setting team is just heading up there to sort it out now. Gives you some idea of how hard these routes are. He's shredding on the bolts, pulling on the quick draws. The route setters are strong climbers. So yeah, there'll be a small delay as he goes up with his toolkit. Probably the first time he's ever done any route setting work in front of 10,000 Chamonix fans, and this is the volume in question. So yeah, we just have a loose volume. So Mina Markovic, she hasn't officially claimed that there's been a technical incident, but she just said to the judges it is loose and it needs tightening.
So she climbed past it, so she can't call it technical.
No, absolutely. So no technical incident, but it does need a little tighten. Don't drop that screw, there's 10,000 people watching. Ah, so clearly the volume itself, not the bolt on hold. It was loose because it's getting some extra self-tapping screws into the wall. Just see a third going. Just to confirm, Mina Markovic, she did get 33 plus on her attempt there. There's our speed climbing wall. Great speed climbing final early. You can check it out on YouTube. And we will have the podium from that later on today. Later on this evening, I should say. 10:30 Chamonix time. Come on, wave to the crowd. Now's your chance. No, too modest. Okay. So we should be able to resume this women's final. She's had a slightly loose volume on the wall. And as Delaney Miller rightly said, no technical incident because Mina Markovic climbed past it. So our next climber out will be Charlotte Durif of France. Also a boulderer, Charlotte Durif. We've already seen her in 2016 at the last Boulder World Cup. She was 13th. Back in 2008, she was second in a Boulder World Cup. She's also won a lead World Cup, and it was right here in Chamonix in front of her home crowd. The only French lady in today's final. We're live coming from Chamonix. Delaney Miller, Team USA, is alongside me. How do you think this route will suit someone like Charlotte?
It's hard to say, but I will say that Charlotte is actually one of my favorite climbers to watch because she's so smart. She's really good at using heel hooks and taking advantage of rests that I usually don't even notice.
You power straight through.
Yeah.
Will be interesting.
But I think this route is a little less technical, so we will see.
Certainly, when we first saw it, your first thought was, this looks slightly easier to read. So as someone who's an expert route reader, some of Charlotte's weaponry might not be quite as powerful today.
Exactly.
Climbing very smoothly so far, just setting herself on that right hand. Now she's heading up towards what Mina Markovic flagged to the judges as a loose volume. Presumably Charlotte was aware there was a loose volume but won't know which one it was, so I wouldn't imagine there'll be any psychology heading up to it. She won't be worrying about it, she won't know that's the volume that's just been bolstered. see a hair blowing around. The wind has picked up again here. We've had very changeable conditions over the past couple of days in Chamonix when the route setters were working. Friday, Saturday, Sunday, glorious hot sunshine when the rest of us arrived on Saturday afternoon, and all day Sunday it was unbearably hot. And yet when I turned up yesterday with a spare t-shirt expecting to need to change due to sweating in the heat, I actually went back to our hotel to get a spare layer because it suddenly went cold. Such is life and weather in the mountains. And Charlotte, it'd be interesting to see that again. Perhaps just a slip there.
Yep.
Did you see if it was the hand or the foot that went?
It happened so fast, but it looks like her foot.
Did initially look like the right foot. It'd be good to see a replay of that. Disappointing end to Charlotte's attempt. Well, as I said, she has won here in Chamonix 2010. Unfortunately for her, she won't be winning here tonight. So the next climber out will be Anne-Sophie Collet.
I don't think I've seen Anne-Sophie Collet in finals before. Is this her first finals?
It is her first finals. Semis here last year in Chamonix. Missed out in Briançon by one place last year. A bit of a heartbreaker. Makes amends today. Also does Boulder, 19-year-old from Biel in Switzerland. We had a great shot of her and Annette van Hooven rehearsing the route together earlier. And she looks, she's got it fairly dialed. Checks with the B layer that she's good to go. Final chalk up and a deep breath, and she'll be on her way. Here she goes. First World Cup final. Delaney, you've climbed in World Cups. How different does it feel as you progress through the rounds? How does the qualifying feel versus the semi-final? Does the pressure come from you, or do you really feel the crowd and the occasion as you progress through the rounds?
Both. Qualifiers, I find, is really difficult because, for me personally, I struggle with getting other people's beta out of my head. And so for me, it's really distracting, but
just explain that. How would you discuss the routes with your compatriots and the other climbers?
Well, for those out there listening who don't know, qualifiers is flash format, meaning you get to watch people and you get a video that you can watch. And for me personally, I find it really mentally challenging because you watch one person who does it one way and then another person who does it another way, and it's just really, it gets really confusing. Semifinals, though, is stressful because all you want to do is make it to finals. So I think finals is actually, it can be like the most stress-free round because you've already made it.
Is that because you're just delighted to be there and anything else is a bonus?
Yeah.
That's a great way of looking at it. The semis is the most stressful, but once you get to the final, you just enjoy it.
Yeah, exactly.
Do you often find that when you're climbing, then you are thinking about other people's beta and other people's way of doing it, particularly in the qualifiers, when you should just focus?
Yeah. My second qualifying route, I realized that was an issue, so I just watched one person and that was it.
So, Anne-Sophie, no issues so far. That volume that her right foot is just leaving now was a bolted loose by Mina Markovic. If you saw that there was someone working on it, it's now been had a few extra screws added to it. It's not going anywhere. The competition's resumed. So now this is the steepest part of the route. She gets on the underside of this enormous red volume in the middle of the wall. Chalk it up before she commits to these steeper moves. Only 19 years old. Climbing like a veteran thus far. They take advantage of the rest position here. No, didn't like that way of doing it. Comes back down, resets, has another rest, another chalk up. So now she launches herself up it. Lunge for that hold.
Looks like a really big move.
That is a big move.
It's a move that Mina just barely snatched.
Mina Markovic, I can report, just walked past our commentary box with a big smile on her face. I think having seen a few of the other climbers, feel slightly better about her performance. She didn't look too disappointed at the time, but she'll feel even better. As we see there, provisional lead. I think it'd be fair to say strong field still to come, but three climbers who've been out. Mina Markovic currently leads away ahead of Anne-Sophie Koller and Charlotte Jarif. Our next climber out will be Yuka Kobayashi. There she is. In the Nakagon region of Japan. Great country. Those of us lucky enough to go to the Boulder World Cup there in Kazo in April. Had a great time. I think just about everyone at the IFSC and most of the climbers fell in love with Japan. Certainly the sushi.
How old is Yuka?
Yuka is 29. She's sixth overall in the lead 2015. She made her debut here in Chamonix way back in 2004. 12 years on, still competing at the highest level. Thus far, climbing perhaps slightly slower than the other climbers we've seen. 50 seconds used up so far. As I say, no one's been timed out in either the men's or the women's competition yet. It could well happen. I have to say, the local DJ here in Chamonix providing some great tunes. Ain't no sunshine when she's gone.
I literally was just about to say the same. It doesn't make a difference when you're climbing because you tune everything out, but whenever you're in the chair, it makes a big difference.
Oh, absolutely, yeah. He's a big fan of the Grateful Dead. We've had their greatest hits on. We've had AC/DC. We've had all the classics. Now a bit of chilled out reggae acoustic. Franchement. You're looking very composed so far. Nice controlled movements. That's a longer move. Sticks it without too much trouble though. Just gets the heel hook set.
I love listening to the Japanese coach because you can distinctly pick him out from the crowd.
Can you provide a translation, please?
He's just saying Gamba. Maybe. Come on.
It's funny, wherever you travel, climbing across the world, you quickly learn the local for come on. Ever climbed in Spain? Venga, venga. Some strapping on that right shoulder of Yuka Kobayashi. Haven't been told of any injury. Certainly hasn't held her back if she has got one into the finals of the lead World Cup here in Chamonix. So far, climbing very neatly. This is very neat and precise climbing. Yep, that's the move that stopped Anne-Sophie Koller. Delaney Miller alongside me predicted that this route would reward precise climbing. So far, that's what Yuka Kobayashi is providing. And she holds it, the move to the lip, Yuka Kobayashi. Just about, this is taking everything that left shoulder's got to keep her on. Now goes to the heel hook.
That's so smart.
Such clever climbing, Yuka Kobayashi. 29, 12 years older than Yanni Gambro, who climbed later. Experience counting for a lot there.
My heel hook theory is holding up.
For those people just joining us, just remind us your heel hook theory.
As long as you can heel hook up by your head, then you can be successful on the routes here in Chamonix.
Well, it's proven the case so far. She's just regaining a bit of strength here. She's on the lip between the steepest part of the wall and a much less steep section. Just composing herself before pulling over. No more left, unfortunately. It looked like she's in complete control up to there.
Yeah.
Never looked in too much doubt, but that one move off the lip. We'll just see where that puts her. Roughly the same part of the route that Mina Markovic fell off. We'll wait to see.
I think Mina had a 33 plus.
Yes, which I think Yuka could have been 33 from what we saw. Let's have a look.
I think it'll be a 33 plus as well.
When we see the scores, we will let you know. In the meantime, four climbers still to go. A gust of wind just blew half our paperwork off our desk. You'll have to excuse us while Delaney Miller goes to retrieve it. I'm still here though. Anna Gehoven out onto the mat. And it's our papers have survived relatively intact. Thanks, Delaney. So Anna seemingly had the route absolutely dialed in her mind during the inspection period, the 6-minute inspection period. Just quietly having a few words with herself before she pulls off the ground. See, they're unusual. She's climbing with either a watch or a heart rate monitor.
It's a watch.
It is a watch.
Yeah, she uses it in ISO. She's very scientific about her warm-up.
Ah, that explains a lot. It's funny, no matter how long you watch competitions for, you find out these little funny little quirks that the climbers have. As I say, she was chatting earlier and seemed to have learnt the route pretty much off by heart in the 6 minutes she had. Will it pay dividends? That's the question. Probably tell the Chamonix DJ here, shifted the tone slightly. We've got some very mellow, don't know how to describe this music. Cheesy, perhaps?
It's not as good.
I think we can agree on that. We've had all sorts. We had Michael Jackson on earlier. Slightly surreal move, watching someone climb to this soundtrack. But he's got to provide music for 2 full days. We can forgive him the odd duffer.
She's moving at a good pace.
She is, yes. As you're climbing as a lead climber, do you ever look at the time, or do you just can you just feel within yourself how much time you've got left, how fast you're going?
It's always in the back of my mind. But I figure if you are timing out, you've probably gotten high enough on the route to have done something right.
It's a good theory. See there, just under 6 minutes to go now for Anouk. No problem so far, barely a shake to indicate she's even trying thus far. And just to give you
just under halfway.
Yes, to give you some idea versus the other competitors we've had up, she's about to enter the very steepest part of the wall on the huge red volume. Just resting. Doesn't seem to have, no, hasn't rested quite as long as some of the climbers. Or perhaps taking a slightly longer rest now. Pull straight through.
She's really good at recovering.
That was the very briefest of rests from Anouk. 4th overall the past 2 years in the lead World Cups.
Next move is the big one.
Yes, big dynamic move here. Just has a final rest. As I say, she seemed to really have the route in her mind at the end of the 6 minute inspection period, so I suspect she knows she's lining up for a dyno here. Took a good long rest. Here she goes.
Easy.
Sticks it, seemingly minimal effort.
She's climbing very well.
This is superb from Anouk Verhoeven. So this was the last hole that Yuka Kobayashi had troll on. She couldn't do the move that Anouk Verhoeven has just done. This will be Anouk Verhoeven in the lead, I think. Still looking in complete control. This is Anouk Verhoeven. Just to remind you, we've already seen Mina Markovic, Charlotte Jarif, and Sophie Koller and Yuka Kobayashi out. And Anouk Verhoeven, so far, doesn't really look like she's encountered a move that she's found particularly difficult. All the moves are appreciate all the moves are tough in a World Cup final route, but doesn't seem to have been one bit where she really had to dig deep and look like she might be off. And she's nearing the end of the 45 degree panel. You can see perfect angle there. Change an angle.
She's got 8 more moves to the top.
Anouk Verhoeven is making a serious statement here. As I say, fourth overall the last 2 years. Incredibly consistent climber. She's never won a World Cup. Is today the day?
She's got enough energy to check the watch.
She's got all the time in the world. She's clipped the last quick draw. The next thing you can clip is the top. We didn't see a top in either semi-final, men's or women's. We didn't see a top in the men's final. We are yet to see one in the women's final either. Are we about to see our first top since our live stream coverage began in this Chamonix Lead World Cup? Annette Verhoeven has looked absolutely unflustered by every move on this route. And surely it's going to top it now. She's got it. Annette Verhoeven. Incredible performance.
So beautiful.
Well, that is absolutely extraordinary. She didn't even look tired. There was no point on that route. She looked in the slightest bit fatigued. She took a couple of short rests and cruised every move.
She could do another lap, it looks like.
What a statement for Annette Verhoeven. So three climbers still to come, trying to equal her achievement. There's the Chamonix crowd, they appreciated that. They haven't seen a top in either semi or final thus far, but they have now. Yeah, just to confirm, there she is. Top, you're quite right, Yuka Kobayashi did get 33 plus, as did Mina Markovic. And Sophie Koller in fourth, and Charlotte Jurif down in fifth. Austria, are you ready to welcome your champion, please? Representing Austria, here's Magdalena Rock.
She's looking really good this year.
She is, climbed superbly earlier on today. Seems to be quite happy, it would seem. The moves, just rehearsing them one more time. Made her debut here in Chamonix in 2010. From Landeck, Austria, in the Vorarlberg region.
22 years old.
Interesting climber, Magdalena. She made steady progress through her early career, as I said. Made her debut here in 2010, first podium 2012, and then won in Imst, just down the road from her hometown, in 2014. She also won the Arco Rock Masters that year and was third in the World Championship. So 2014, her best year so far. 15th overall last year, only one final, Wu Zhang.
She's moving at a good pace.
She is, she's climbing quickly. You mentioned earlier, Delaney, that you're generally considered a slower climber.
Yeah.
Do most of the climbers have the ability to switch gears, or do you find it really hard to suddenly switch into, okay, I need to go quickly, away from your natural style?
I find it really difficult. And even whenever I think I'm going faster, usually I'm not.
It's all in the mind, I guess.
Yeah.
I say 15th overall last year for Magdalena Rock. She's guaranteed at least 8th here by making this final.
Get your Maggie. She's strong, huh? She's in form this year. Allez tout le monde, on la lâche pas parce qu'elle est très rapide, la Galère la Rose pour le moment. Beaucoup plus rapide me semble-t-il qu'elle
est Just to give you a landmark, she's just approaching that very steepest part of the route around the red volume.
The part that I swear is 60 degrees.
It is extremely steep. One thing I know, it's certainly a lot closer to the horizontal than it is to vertical. There we can see it. Chalk bag is always a good indicator of just how steep the wall is, and you can see there the angle it's hanging up.
Now the music is much better.
There we go. Adam Mahouf seems to react to the very mellow music. It just cruised up the route. I mean, I'm still getting over that piece of climbing from here. Very rare. You see someone seemingly find a workup final route. Well, easier. You can't avoid the word easy. She really just didn't seem to have any difficulty with any move on it.
It was flawless.
It was an absolutely perfect performance, but Magdalena Rock, Jane Kim, and Yanya Garnbret can equal it.
She's passed the bottleneck.
Has. That's where Yuka Kobayashi and Mina Markovic were struggling. So for those new to lead climbing, just explain to us what will happen if we get more than one top in terms of ranking.
It'll be a count back to speed.
Magdalena just set herself. She's about to pull onto the very top panel here. No, she's not. She was very close to pulling onto the top panel there.
That'll put her in second.
Jane Kim will be our next climber out. I thought she is a serious contender to top this route. It's already been topped. Anna Grahoven. And that Chamonix crowd that you can see there absolutely loved it. And there you have the confirmation. Anna Grahoven, one of the most impressive tops I can ever remember seeing in the lead World Cup. This 28-year-old Jane Kim of Korea.
Her first World Cup was in 2004.
Yes, right here in Chamonix, they made the debuts together. Jane Kim has won 25 World Cups in lead alone. She also won a Boulder World Cup. On vous a dit de cacher les yeux de vos femmes pour Sean McCall. Mesdames, faites attention à vos hommes. On envoie. Won the overall competition in 2014. Second to Mina Markovic last year. She has got a battle on her hands. This first lead World Cup of the season in Chamonix. Alors, il peut se passer un sale truc, c'est évident, mais. On va dire que sur. Alors elle, c'est 100% de finale depuis le début de sa carrière. C'est.
elle nous a rarement fait d'autres performances.
Et parfois sur des mouvements vraiment un petit peu dynamiques d'engagement, elle se fait surprendre, mais dans ce style de vol, normalement, elle a tout ce qu'il faut pour aller au sommet.
L'année dernière, elle a terminé deuxième des classements général de la Coupe du Monde. C'est la championne du monde en titre. Elle a été plusieurs fois championne du monde.
Oui. En revanche, sur cette voie, elle n'est que deuxième du classement provisoire des demi-finales. Donc le sommet, ça peut ne pas être suffisant pour elle.
C'est vrai parce que si elle prend le sommet, on vous rappelle qu'elle passera automatiquement devant.
So, Jane Kim. She's in the Delaney Miller Like to Climb Slow and Steady Club. She can hang on forever. She's certainly climbing. I have to say, quite slowly here. This is still only the second panel on the route. Not anywhere near the huge volume just yet. The volume that dominates the middle of this wall.
How tall is Jane?
That's a very good question. Off the top of my head, I don't know.
She's very short.
I would guess from standing next to around 5'3".
No, because I'm 5'3".
Really? Smaller? Yeah. Okay.
She's got to be like 5'.
Doesn't seem to hold her back. As I say, 25 lead World Cup wins. Obviously, as a shorter climber myself, I'm always pleading that being small is a disadvantage. It's an interesting thought, actually. Do you think that a particular build is suited to lead or boulder? Because we see climbers of all sorts of builds in both competitions.
Yeah, I don't know. It's definitely the full spectrum.
You've got Ramonet, who I'd imagine, Ramon Julian, by that I mean, who I'd imagine is perhaps even smaller than Jane Kim, yet he's an extraordinary climbing career. Jane Kim. Yeah, you don't want to say necessarily as a negative, because she knows what she's doing, but Jane Kim certainly in no rush here. As I've said, though, she can hang on all day. So it's just a case, I'd imagine, of whether she can actually climb fast enough rather than whether she can hold on to the holes long enough.
The next hold is the halfway point. Actually, she's past it, so.
Yeah. Yep, she is past halfway, heading up towards the section that stopped Mina Markovic in her tracks.
Wow, such control.
She does look very composed, Jane Kim. Are we about to see another top? Just joining us, Annick Verhoeven. Topped out with an absolutely extraordinary 6 or 7 minutes on the wall. Oh, Jane Kim. That didn't look 100%.
No, it didn't.
Recovered now, though.
I think that just comes from her being one of the shorter competitors.
I think so. Her foot just seemed to cut loose in a way that it didn't for Annick Verhoeven, who is much, much taller than her. I'm sure that over the course of a route, certainly over the course of a lead season, these things even themselves out, but that move certainly didn't seem to favour Jane Kim, but she just about hung on. and is now back to composed, almost relaxed on the wall, excuse me. Still looking composed, heading for that top panel where the angle really begins to kick back. 2 minutes left. I can't believe I doubted her. She's timed it pretty much to perfection. I thought she was using up a bit too much time. And I suspect she's got more than enough. Case of just doing the moves now. I don't think she'll be timed out. Onto the final section of the route. That's the last quick draw clipped.
This is where Nock took a good rest. Right before the slopers.
Jane Kim's so close now. Will we see another top? Jane Kim, that is about as close as you can get to the top without making it. She still looks happy enough. Is that a wave to the crowd or a slap on the thighs in frustration? Suspect it might have been a slap on the thighs, and then there's a wave to the crowd.
I don't think I've ever seen her too frustrated.
No, she seems to take it all in a stride. I suppose 25 World Cup wins in lead will do that to you. She's just wondering what went wrong there. So our last climber out will be Janja Garnbret, 17-year-old Slovenian, nothing short of a sensation. Three World Cups entered in lead climbing last year. She finished second, second and third. And from those three World Cups alone, that was enough to net her seventh place overall. Here she is. This extraordinary 17-year-old is not won a World Cup before, but still be fair to say she's taken the competition climbing scene by storm, and she's taken this route by storm. Allowed 40 seconds at the bottom. Doesn't need it.
Nope.
Firing up here.
She's definitely one of the more aggressive climbers.
Very unusual to see a climber just come out and fire straight up it, but that's how she rolls.
It obviously works.
It obviously works. Absolutely.
She's also very nice. I secretly get super excited every time she likes my Instagram pictures.
She's never liked one of my Instagram pictures. You know what? I'm just flat out jealous. I'm not even going to pretend. Yeah, she's taken the competition climbing scene by storm, it would seem.
Ça a été une belle expérience avec des podiums déjà. Là,
So Yann, you're absolutely flying up this route, approaching this steepest section already. Well, Annick Verhoeven, who topped the route, is incredibly composed and controlled throughout. Yanya Gamba, it's as if she's going to war. Just battling the route straight up it. Finally takes a rest.
Jaine was a full minute behind her at this point.
She was, yeah. When you think that they've only covered around half the wall at that stage, it's an extraordinary difference in speed. No problem so far. Just taking a really prolonged rest here. She fired up that lower section of the route. Just a bit of trivia for you. She can confirm that Jane Kim is 153 centimetres, which to an English person like myself means absolutely nothing.
I have no idea.
Of course, Americans are fellow users of feet. That's pretty much 5 foot flat, I'm told.
I guess is right.
Elle avait sorti la voie de finale l'année dernière comme Mina Markovic, mais elle était en rétro-procédure sur les questions.
She's looking really good.
Mina, donc elle avait terminé deuxième.
She really is. On va voir si the pace has slowed a bit. The rate she fired up that lower section. It's extraordinary, but she's really slowed it down. Remember, she's only 17. It's not out of the question that she just miscalculated her speed. It just won't be as experienced as some of these athletes. Or perhaps she just wanted to get the relatively easy lower section done. Have plenty of time and energy left for the top section. We don't know, but the pace has slowed slightly. There we see her. That's the final quick draw before the top that you can see in your shot there. Top of our spotlight.
She's
having a really good shake out before this final section, Yanya. Yeah, the wind again has picked up. You can see her hair blowing around. You see the chalk flying off when she blows her hands. Here she goes, launching herself onto the top section. 17-year-old, never won a World Cup. What a statement this would be. Feet just slip, just needs to compose herself. Feet slip again, and she hangs on. Jaine Kim got this far but wasn't able to top the route. Certainly not in the bag just yet. Yanya Gambre just composed herself. Needs to keep her cool. As I say, we've seen Jaine Kim get this far and not make it. We saw Annick Verhoeven get this far and make it comfortably. So it can be done. The route has been topped this evening.
Go.
I think Yanya's got this in the bag. 17-year-old Yanya Gambre tops the route. And look at what it means to her. There it is.
Very impressive.
Extraordinary climbing, Yannick Gambre.
Wow.
17 years old. Unbelievable.
Such an inspiration.
And you can see the rain's coming down quite hard now in Chamonix. Yannick Gambre won't care. What a performance. There's some pressure put on her there by Annick Verhoeven. Let's watch that again. Look, just as she went for the left hand that she might just slip, but no, she held it no problem. And she's absolutely over the moon, just looking for her trainers. Keeps her rock boots on and just stamps her trainers on. The MC goes up to join her. It's taken a bit out of her. She's still catching her breath.
Those stairs are actually really slippery.
On va célébrer les podiums et ensuite on se fait plaisir. On se rapproche du 14 juillet.
We're just waiting for our final results here. Remember that there are appeals processes. Once all that has been sorted, we will have a final result for you. But what a final! So you said you were looking forward to seeing Yannick Gambre. She didn't let you down.
No, she didn't. She's definitely an inspiration.
There's our speed wall, as I say. Ah, here we go. So, Yannick Gambre wins today's competition. She topped the route, as did Annick Verhoeven, Jane Kim, Magdalena Rock, Yuka Kobayashi, Mina Markovic, and Sophie Koller, and Charlotte Juriff make up the rest of the top eight. Extraordinary performance from Yannick Gambre. Annick Verhoeven, much as Yannick powered up the route, Annick's ascent was absolutely incredible. Never seen anybody make a World Cup final route look, well, frankly, easy. So the Amit Jane Kim takes the third place on the podium. She came very close to topping, fell off a couple of moves from the end. And now the DJ's shifted onto Europop. Had all sorts here to await the men's results. So Delaney, you've had a look at the competition now. How do you feel going into the next couple of World Cups?
You know, I feel surprisingly okay. Obviously the women's field is very talented though, so I don't know where my okay feeling is coming from.
So there we go, men's. Domen Skofic, double win for Slovenia. Stefano Gisolfi took second by virtue of a plus, 48 plus. Jakub Schubert up to 48. Katia Zupa, 48 as well. Romain de Grange, 47. Sebastian Helenka, 46 plus. Also 46 plus, Sean McColl. And Francesco Vettorata takes eighth place. Sebastian Helenka ranks above Sean McColl on count back there, 6th and 7th. I'll just quickly run you through the ranking points that you get for the various finishes today. So in IFSC World Cups, if you rank first, you take home 100 overall points, second 80 points, third 65 points. You come fourth 55 points, fifth place nets you 51, sixth place 47 points. 7th place gets you 43 and 8th place gets you 40 as we watch an extraordinary bit of climbing from Yannick Gambre. It didn't have that incredible composure of Annick Verhoeven, but Yannick Gambre was just not for giving up. Here we see Yannick. By this stage, the wind had really picked up. It hasn't really died down. I have to say, the temperature's absolutely plummeted here.
I'm sitting here shivering.
Yeah, When we say goodbye later on, you'll notice my co-commentator's got a slightly different outfit on. She's added a down jacket, and I have to add, I'm ever so slightly envious. Temperature's gone through the floor here in Chamonix. So Yann Ugambre, that is the clean sweep, won the qualifying, won the semi, most importantly won the final, ranked first in every round. To see that final top out one more time. This is the part where Jane Kim just slipped. I thought we were going to see her top it. Not quite.
I think if she hadn't backed down, then she would have had it.
It was mighty close from Jane Kim. It was more than close from Yann Ugambre, excuse me. Absolutely delighted. And there's our podium backdrop. On va laisser place à notre président de la Fédération internationale d'escalade qui va nous rejoindre. Il va être accompagné du président de la Fédération française, accompagné évidemment de Monsieur le maire Éric Fournier. Et vous ne saviez pas, mais derrière ce mur, hein, pendant la finale avec la pluie, on avait quand même pas mal de grimpeurs du club des sports de Cham. We're just about to welcome onto the stage IFSC President Marco Scolaris and the Chamonix crowd. I'm pleased to see staying out to watch the medals be awarded. As you can see, rain falling hard now. It's come and gone all evening. Fortunately back, but as I say, most of the crowd hang around to see the end of proceedings. Chamonix MC just getting a bit more microphone time in before Marco Scolaris will be up on stage. Here's Marco Scolaris onto the stage in Chamonix. Accompagné de Monsieur le maire de Chamonix, Éric Fournier. Éric Fournier, maire of Chamonix. De Pierre-Henri Paillasson, directeur général de la FFME. Very important, man. Président du club des sports, Xavier Roserne, maire des Ouches et premier vice-président de la communauté de communes de la vallée de Chamonix. Alain Richier, président de la section escalade du club. The other dignitaries on the stage are the presidents of the FFME and the various clubs de sport in the Chamonix Valley. And we will hear from Marco Scolaris.
Bonsoir à tous, encore une fois, quel spectacle. Malheureusement, on commence cette cérémonie avec une belle piste. Quelqu'un qui a donné beaucoup à l'escalade, le responsable de la commission juge de l'IFSC, président du jury, le responsable d'une des plus grandes salles du monde, IMST, organisatrice des championnats du monde jeune deux fois, et nous a quittés la semaine passée. Donc je vous demande une minute de silence en mémoire de Suzy Knabel. Merci.
I was hoping that would come through the microphones. And I was also hoping we'd get it in English. Unfortunately not, for those of you who didn't understand. It was a short tribute and a moment of silence for Suzy Knabel, a very valued member of the IFSC family who recently passed away. A lovely short speech. The French speakers amongst you will have understood from Marco Scolaris, perfectly observed moment of silence.
On est vraiment pas loin. Et je crois que Chamonix a été toujours une étape très importante
Now we resume the normal formalities, which will culminate in the podium ceremony.
Aller aux Jeux Olympiques n'est pas facile. Mais vraiment, cette fois, nous attendons le mois d'août. Les trois, il y aura la décision de la session.
On y est, hein?
Oui, presque. Non, il faut quand même respecter les procédures. Il y a la session du CIO qui va se réunir du 2 au 4. Alors, du jour 3, il y a justement les 5 sports additionnels qui seront proposés
just hearing pour le 2020. Marcus Kolaris, about how much we've enjoyed the competition. What a great show Chamonix's put on. Couldn't agree more.
Un peu rapide, je vais pas aller sur les plates-bandes de Marco avec l'IFSC, la Fédération Internationale. Moi, je tiens à remercier Monsieur le Maire et le Club des Sports de Chamonix, qui nous ont toujours très très bien accueillis ici. C'est toujours un plaisir d'être ici. D'ailleurs, on n'en rate pas beaucoup.
I have to say, this is a French event, so everybody will be keen to get on the microphone, chip in. That's what's happening so far. All part of the fun. As I say, the glaring issue here is the temperature. I'm sure the athletes backstage, not to mention the media team, really starting to feel it. Looks like Marco Scolaris is the same.
Un feu d'artifice à 17 millions d'euros. Monsieur le maire de Chamonix. Et c'est la seule chose qui augmente quand même au monde, c'est le prix du feu d'artifice.
That is the coolest mayor I've ever seen, Eric Fournier, mayor of Chamonix. He's been mayor of Chamonix for quite a long time, certainly as long as I can remember.
I'd be psyched if I was mayor of Chamonix.
A good gig. He actually, I believe, lives up one of the hills in Chamonix, in a small hamlet called Coupeau. And whether it's true or not, the rumour has it that if you live below the mayor, then your road is always clear of snow. And if you live above him, you have to wait a bit longer for the snow ploughs. The mayor gets priority, so they plough up to his house so he can get to work. The people further up in Coupeau have to manage. Whether it's true or not, I don't know, but it's an amusing rumour. The snow ploughers look after the mayor. Just big thank you there to Marco Scolaris from the mayor of Chamonix, Eric Fournier.
Oui, on va voilà pour libérer l'entrée. On a quatre podiums à faire. On va commencer par le podium de la vitesse, il va vous séduire grave. Applaudissements pour les trois médaillés féminins de la vitesse. On va appeler Mademoiselle Anouk Jobert, Alexandra Rudzinska et Anna Ciganova.
Now the podium ceremony will get underway. And if you're thinking, that doesn't look like our three winners. The reason for that is that this is the podium ceremony for the speed climbing competition earlier today. Anna Ciganova was in third place. There she is. We didn't have the podium immediately after the speed competition, so the athletes have had a bit of waiting to do, but they've been treated to a fantastic lead final to entertain them in the meantime. And Anna Ciganova will beat Claudia Bukcek in the small final this afternoon. Takes her bronze medal and looks absolutely delighted with it. She'll take home 65 ranking points in the overall standings.
Round of applause for Alexandra Rudzinska!
Alexandra Rudzinska, she was second.
Pierre Liu, notre président de la Fédération Française, qui remet la médaille. Monsieur Xavier Roserne, maire des Ouches, premier vice-président de la communauté de communes de la Vallée de Chamonix, va remettre.
She looks delighted as well.
Le bouquet et le chèque accompagné de Marie-Noël Fleury, vice-président de la communauté de communes en charge des sports. Et alors attention, à la première place de la Coupe du Monde de vitesse de Chamonix, représentant la France et pour la deuxième année consécutive,
Applaudissements pour Anouk Jobert!
The woman she couldn't beat the final though is Anouk Jobert. She won today in pretty challenging conditions. It was raining hard throughout the speed final. So just to confirm what this does to the overall rankings, Yulia Kaplina is in first place in the overall speed climbing rankings after three World Cups we've had today in Chamonix, Nanjing and Chongqing in China a couple of months ago. Just hear the French national anthem. Anouk Jobert from our home crowd sings the Marseillaise, in my humble opinion, one of the finest national anthems out there. And plenty of people joining the crowd. So there we have it, Anouk Jobert taking the win ahead of Alexandra Rudzinska. And Anna Siganova. And just before the anthem began, I was about to tell you what that did to the overall standings after three World Cups. It means Yulia Kaplina leads away, but she's only 6 points ahead of Alexandra Rudzinska, who we just saw in second place, and Anouk Jobert is 9 points further back after winning today. Claudia Buchek is in fourth, and Anna Siganova, today's bronze medalist, is in fifth place in the overall standings. Alla Marenic, sixth. Nina Lack, seventh. Aurelia Saracen, eighth. Adita Ropek is ninth. And Puna Masari Ita Triana is in tenth. Now we move on to the men.
Round of applause, please, for Mr. Reza Halilbolsheva.
Reza Halilbolsheva. If you watched today's speed final, I'm sure you'll remember his celebration when he won the small final to claim third place.
It was quite the celebration.
It was quite the celebration, wasn't it? We've had a full day of competition here. Those of you who missed the action and they're just tuning in to see who won and watch the podiums, and you're wondering why we have speed climbers, it's because we're having the speed climbing podium from earlier today, just before we have the lead climb podium. Libor Horosa, second today, made a slip quite early on in the final, it just cost him. And my co-commentator, Delaney Miller, you train with Libor. Pleased with today's result?
Yes. I think he did very well. I think he's pleased too.
He is. He initially looked disappointed, but I think when you got time to reflect on it,
yeah,
you're much happier.
We'll just get him next time.
He will get him next time. The man he couldn't beat, though, is Marcin Zienski. Polish climber. Had a tough run, he had to beat Reza Halilbolsheva to reach the final, and then he had to beat Libor Horosa to win it, and he managed it. We will hear the Polish national anthem after this, at which point I'll give you a quick rundown of where that leaves the overall standings.
Welcome the national anthem, Poland.
Thank you. Masiewski just milking the applause of the crowd.
Congratulations.
Unfortunately, mainly due to the weather and the time of day, the speed climbers didn't enjoy the same size crowd we had this evening for the lead final, so great that they get the chance to receive their medals in front of such a big and appreciative crowd as we get here in Chamonix. So hopefully just have time to run you down the top 10 in the overall standings of the Speed World Cup men's competition. After three rounds, Libor Herosa still leads away despite only taking second today. He's on 240 points, 20 points behind him is Marcin Zienski. Reza Ali Porchena, who took third today, is also third in the overall standings. And I'll be quick because the ladies are out. Dmitry Timofey fourth, Stanislav Kokorin fifth, Daniel Boldyrev is sixth, Vasa Mawem is seventh in the overall standings, Alexandra Shilov eighth, Leonardo Gontero ninth, and Evgeny Vaitsakovsky is 10th. That is the speed climbing and the lead climbing. There's Jane Kim claiming incredibly close to topping the route today. Slipped off towards the end. Maybe one or two moves to the end. Still looks pretty happy with her result though.
Silver medal, second place, representing Belgium. Applaudissements, s'il vous plaît, mesdames et messieurs, pour Anna Verhoeven!
Anna Verhoeven, she didn't win today. Count back to previous rounds to decide the winner, but I have to say, if we were awarding gold medals for impressive climbing, she would have taken mine today.
She definitely
styled it out. We saw it, we commented on it during the observation period of the route. She seemed to have every move dialed and she got on the route and confirmed that. However, clean sweep. Top the qualifiers, top the semis, top the final. Janja Garnbret wins her first ever World Cup. Something tells me it won't be her last. 17 years old, half the age of one of the male finalists, Romain Desgranges. I've said that a few times today, I'm sorry Romain, but it does just hammer home how young the Slovenian sensation is.
And please welcome the Slovenian national anthem.
Yeah, the Slovenian national anthem. Something tells me that won't be the last time we hear the Slovenian national anthem. We're all going to know it off by heart. I think Janja Garnbret, 17 years old, already a World Cup winner. So in her four World Cups she's entered, it's been second, second, third, first. Never missed a podium in the four World Cups she's entered in lead climbing. An extraordinary record. I have to say though, Anna Verhoeven, as we mentioned it so many times this evening, so impressive. Any slip up from Janja, Anna is going to be right there. Jane Kim, of course, never discount her, third today. And here are the men.
Ladies and gentlemen, bronze medal, third place representing Austria. Round of applause for Mr. Jakob Schumer!
as Jakob Schubert takes third place. Had a bit of a disappointing season overall in the Boulder World Cups he entered. He'll be delighted to be back on a World Cup podium.
He looks very pleased.
He looks delighted. It wasn't the neatest climbing. I don't wish to be critical. World Cup podium's not to be sniffed at, but he didn't look his solid best. But it gives you an idea just how good he is. He can still take third in a World Cup. Just behind Stefano Gisolfi. Climbed brilliantly across the 2 days, not just today.
And ladies and gentlemen, representing Slovenia, gold medal and winner tonight here for the World Cup, Mr. Domen Skofic!
Domen Skofic! He won his first World Cup last year. He wins his second here in Chamonix.
And it's
two wins for Slovenia, one in the men's competition and one in the women's. I said we'd be getting to know the Slovenian national anthem very well. We're going to hear it again. Make sure you check out our highlights later. We will be grabbing a word with Domen and Janja.
Welcome the Slovenian national anthem.
And Jakob and Stefano, and Stefano, here's him, join Domen on the podium. Widest smile in Chamonix belongs to Domen Skofic this evening.
Was an amazing crowd tonight, you were just wonderful. Thank you very much for everything. Don't move.
Well, what a wonderful start to the lead climbing season 2016. So many talking points, but unfortunately we are out of time. However, you don't have to wait long for us to discuss them, because we are back in just 2 days, 15th and 16th. We will be in Villar, Switzerland. Huge thanks to Delaney Miller for joining me. We'll see you in a few days.
Thank you so much for having me.
Vous offre, alors évidemment, on est dans des conditions extrêmes, hein, comme l'image de nos finales ce soir. Et bon, on va fêter l'approche de la fête nationale tous ensemble.